This is the setup of the French forces for the game of Austerlitz by the international team. You can see there's a red line which shows the extent of their forward possibility. There's also another red line which is the extent of forward possibility of the Russian and Austrian forces. The French set up first, and I just wanted to have a show a little bit of an idea of the different forces before I set up the Allies. Essentially, the French have six commands. For them, that's five corps and reserve. The reserve comes in three parts. We essentially have the cavalry reserve here, and there's Napoleon, who starts out in the pants marked there. Just a note on the factors on him. He has a six combat adjustment factor and a range of 12. So his is the greatest range. The other commanders have a range of 6, within which they can adjust the benefit of their combat factors. And he has a movement factor of 6. The other commanders generally have a movement factor of 9. So he's not as maneuverable, but he has a big reach. So there's some artillery reserve here, here, and some more cavalry and artillery reserve here. So we've got the artillery and cavalry reserve here around Napoleon. Then over here we have Bernadotte, and he has a corps here. So each corps generally has some light infantry, some artillery, and some cavalry. There's Bessieres here. Excuse my pronunciation of these commands. I don't know how to pronounce their names correctly. Here's lines placed here, and then over on this side we have the route or the rue, waiting in the wings for his entry, variable entry, but by 9:30, by about the fourth turn. And then we have Soult's forces here, kind of spread out along this area. So these numbers here designate quadrants, numbered quadrants. So this quadrant's 24, this quadrant will be 23, where the force is set up. So generally each force is given a quadrant. Soult is scattered across here. You have to place at least two of these units in each quadrant. So you see we have the bulk of the French over here, Soult here as it was historically, and then the Third Corps coming in here as reinforcements. Now, my appreciation of this game has grown. I played three quarters of a game to try and get used to the system. I realised in my overview I've made a few mistakes, so I learnt some things in that. At first I started getting frustrated, thinking, oh, this is kind of quite abstract and it's not really going to give a very good feel for the era, but I find that it's, although it's sort of fairly abstract, it's got interesting design choices. So for example, the light infantry have a combat factor of 2, while the regular infantry units have a combat factor of 1 less than the light infantry. But in fact, what that means is light infantry can join a formation, but if they do join a formation, that they're only counted for one strength point as a normal unit. Normal units fight better in formation, whereby each of these would then have a factor of four, because it's supported by its three comrades. So they would all each be worth four. And that, if that was in the formation, would be just the same. But if a normal unit is out of formation on its own, it only has a comrade factor of one, whereas a light infantry, who obviously fight better, and that way that's their speciality, their comrade factor is higher. So I can see that formations are very important here. Something else which I noticed is that there's no combat effect of fighting across, like the rivers or the ridge lines, or I don't know ridge lines, but level lines. However, a formation cannot be maintained crossing a hill line or a river, or indeed if crossing over a bridge. So that's going to bring some interesting play in, because it means if you are defending behind the river, there's no bonus against an opponent on the other side. However, with no advance after combat, you might push your opponent back, but then you cannot come over the river in formation, only in bits and bobs in a weakened state. So it's going to make the tactics quite interesting. After my initial sort of partial playthrough, it started to give me a feel of kind of like chess in a way. Here's the king, and the other fellow's kings are on the other side. And if you capture each other's king, that's it, game over. Otherwise, it's won on points. I say chess-like because a piece can move and attack, and then another piece can move and take advantage of the result of that attack. So you will move some. You'll move pieces to support each other like that. This is obviously the design intent, that you'll fire some artillery and maybe cause a retreat, break somebody's formation. Then you'd move your formation up, attack their now reduced formation, and then send in the cavalry after to run down the retreating units from behind, which essentially, I guess, is more or less what the combat was like in that time. We'll see how it works out in these dimensions. So here's the Austrians and the Russians waiting to be set up. Now, they don't have corps as such, but they actually have nine commands. So the French as a whole have six commands. You take their reserve, reserves as one piece. The Austrians are fielding nine commands, so they've got perhaps a greater flexibility of maneuver there. However, their leaders have things like three points for effecting attack, maybe 4 points. He's only got one. And Kutuzov, the leader, this represents the total's command. Has five against Napoleon's six, and you see his range is only six. All of these leaders only have a range of six, so their leaders do not add as much. Whilst the where's Sue himself on there? There he is. Whilst the French leaders generally muster 4 points. So, I was adding up the disparity in the units, and maybe I'll speak about that later, but that's what I wanted to say at the moment.
Here we are at the start of the second Russian tour. I just wanted to use this moment to illustrate some of the tactical difficulties that the situation presents. You see here we have a level line, and we have the French here and the Russians here with some artillery. According to the line of sight rules, the level line blocks artillery fire, so this artillery cannot fire on these fellows. If, however, the artillery was here next to the level line, it could fire upon these folks. If these folks, conversely, if these folks are here, the artillery would not have line of sight to them, so it could effectively just fire straight over them. So the French had an option in their turn whether just to pass over the river or go right up here and take themselves out of line of sight of artillery fire. If the artillery stopped on the top of the ridge, on the other hand, of course, the artillery could come right down to here and be at point-blank range and range of canister, which enables eliminations of the unit, not just mere retreats on the artillery fire table. See here, on a range of three, there's a possible elimination. But not for light artillery. Even for light artillery. See the reddish bees, sort of but the problem, if the artillery come down here, then they're going to need infantry support. At the moment, this infantry is in line formation. There's actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and there's an infantry under there, 7, 8, all in the line. The maximum bonus you get is a +3. So that could be considered as two separate line formations, each infantry unit then having a strength of 4. However, you cannot maintain formation when crossing an obstacle. And you cannot break formation and then recreate it in the same turn. You could, the Russians could move down, they would break formation, line up here, so they could not use that formation for the attack. But it would be in effect for the next turn, which would be the French counterattack. So if they move their cannon into position, if they move their cannon down to here, then their infantry are going to potentially get driven back, or even the artillery will get driven back by this strong formation. If they leave their cannons up here, then the French could just move to here the next turn, be out of artillery range, or out of artillery effectiveness, and then they could assault without, or they could wait there, maybe for a later assault. Okay, so that was just really an illustration of the line of sight rules. And the problems of maintaining formations over ridges, and you cannot maintain a formation crossing a river. Now, another thing worth mentioning is that in the semi-game I played prior to this, the French force's greatest enemy, at least on this side of the board, was the board edge, because any unit that moves out off the board edge, it does not come back effectively, it is eliminated. And you can see that with retreats often going up to 5 points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you could stand by that river and retreat there. If you move back at all, any retreat, you're off the board and out of the game. So the French lost a lot of units over here, mainly to retreats off the board. So So I felt that necessitated them having somewhat of an offensive stance, hence these fellows moving up. Equally, if you retreat over a river, you are in fact eliminated. It's not possible. So these guys are in an awkward position with their backs to the water. They want to go forward. Or perhaps they should come back and then hope to hold the Russians on the river line. Because once the Russians are over the river line, the French are going to be retreating too far. So I'll do some movement in this area and then we'll see how the situation has transpired. It's the Russians and Austria. Okay, at this point here, the Austrians are going to attempt artillery fire to attempt to retreat on this unit. That would break up this line and render these guys in a formation of two, so they'll be worth 2 points each, and that light infantry will be two on its own, instead of the 4 points each as they have here, which would then enable the light infantry to move forward and have some chance in breaking this line up. We also have a leader here. The leaders move last after fighting, after movement and combat. So he's only got a leadership factor of two, but a range of six. But men aren't in formation, so that probably won't be coming in. He's just in range to support those with his leadership factor. Okay, let's see how it goes. The artillery is at a range of four. Now 2d6, we get six. So that brings us to nothing. Okay, no effect. The artillery is fired. So we've had some movement here. Essentially the light infantry are moving up around here, and we have an infantry line formed here. That artillery from here moving up. So their commander will stay with them to support that attack. Light infantry moving around to try and outflank. They were unable to do that. Or if you've got light infantry, don't need to spend a point to move to turn, because normally infantry needs a point to move to turn in space. Okay, so they're going to be facing like that. I didn't want them to come into contact with that strong formation there. But they could only move forward because these fellows moved off the line, so they will have assembled their formation by the French turn. They could perhaps move further forward. I think they left them there. I thought I would just illustrate how the movement works while fielding these folks. So I think what we want is these light infantry to move forward to try and flank these, but they'll have to deal with this now as well. And there's more light infantry here. So, 1, 2, 3 for the rebel, 4, and if you remain, your sort of zone of control is the hex immediately in front. If you remain there, if you do not assault the unit directly to your front, they have the chance to assault you back immediately. These ones cannot fire at the flank, so that would be the case. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So he's going to have a flank attack. And so is he. Let's do those attacks immediately. So
Okay, during the retreat. Okay, as far as I can tell, rivers do not affect combat. I thought I'd read somewhere that artillery are not affected by rivers in combat, but I can't find that plagues in there. I can't find any other mention of rivers in combat, so I'd have to ignore that. So, river. The difficulty of the world is that as they're written, you can't. All subdivided clearly and organized in a logical manner, because there's some bits referred to sections earlier on where they should have been placed and they can sort of be tacked on a later paragraph. Without all of that, it's quite difficult to grasp the rules as a whole. Okay, so I think I have it clear. So this is two against one. Artillery not counted. Do not have a reduction for being attacked from the side and rear. So that's a plus one differential and one difficulty. Four, we have a no result. Okay, fine. And he has plus one for attacking the side. Oh no, so that's cavalry then. So again, that's just going to be one differential, all of three new effects. Okay, so they're in place. Of formation there, although he can't in this formation. There's a gap that might be exploitable by his hands. And it's very important where you place your fellows, because if someone's forced into a retreat, they go in a straight line, and often that means they're going to retreat over their fellows, thereby disorganizing them, and if they have been reduced themselves, they reduce their fellows. So the greatest combat values are obtained by the morale of units working. On the converse, the greatest combat effects are obtained by a unit of reduced morale cascading that effect down into other units. Okay, so I've performed a movement round here, now I'll perform a movement on the rest of the board and see what transpires. So these fellows moved up. Lone artillery and infantry unit moved here to threaten the cavalry, which may attempt to charge. And then infantry, light infantry and artillery have lined up here, so they've got a solid formation in preparation for an assault here. Essentially what I think what each side is trying to do is to find a break in the other side's line, whereby they can then exploit it with cavalry sweep, because when they each have a mass of cavalry, as well as individual cavalry units attached to their command, And that if you can get your massive cavalry behind your enemy, attacking from the rear, forcing lots of retreats, that's going to break his army to pieces. However, they both have their cavalry amassed on this side of the board, not down here. So here's the Russian cavalry mass, and there is a reserve of it here, ready to exploit a potential breakthrough here. And the French cavalry was kind of like here. It's now split, and it's horse artillery have been sent down here to support this side, which was lacking artillery. And the heavy cavalry are making their way around here to support this side against the threat from the Russian cavalry.
I think that's about it for now, I think.